When thinking about a haunting, it is typical to either see a rational explanation or the presence of a ghost or human spirit. Yet there are other explanations which are far more ancient. It is thought by some that primordial spirits exist within the elements all around us, and that they may be the beings responsible for much alleged paranormal phenomena. Whilst the term elemental may be one which many are unfamiliar with, you will most certainly have heard of some types of elemental creatures, with such beings littering folklore across the world. Creatures like fairies, gnomes, and mermaids are all considered to be elemental beings. Such elementals are thought to exist within the four basic elements of nature: earth, wind, water, and fire. They are claimed to travel unseen within these elements. When talking about such beings in the 16th century, the philosopher and alchemist Paracelsus described them as creatures that are outside the cognizance of the light of nature. Whilst it is said that these energies are invisible to most of us, some occultists claim it is not impossible to willingly see an elemental being. According to William Godwin, an English novelist and philosopher, certain Rosicrucians, members of an esoteric fraternal order, believe that elemental beings can be seen once the eyes are cleansed with a legendary alchemical medicine known as panacea. After this medicine is used, the initiate would have to chemically prepare a glass globe, which contained one or many elements. After being exposed to sunlight for a month, they would be able to see innumerable beings of a luminous substance, but of thin and evanescent nature. These beings, it is claimed, people the elements on all sides of us. Other paranormal practitioners, however, have argued that no such rituals are necessary for seeing elementals. In regards to fire elementals, it is said that they can be seen at sunrise or sunset, or close to bonfires, furnaces, and fires of all kinds. As elementals are claimed to personify and embody a specific force of nature, catching a glimpse of these otherwise invisible beings is most likely to happen in their natural habitat. What allegedly differentiates elementals from human beings is not just their elusive and oft-times invisible nature, but rather that their soul is completely mortal. Those who are spiritually minded, from religious practitioners to occultists, believe that the human soul is immortal. After physical death, our soul lives on in some form of afterlife. An elemental, on the other hand, is said to have a longer life, but when such a being dies, there is no afterlife. Due to the finality of their existence, they desire the immortality of the human soul, and yearn to have a part of it, and thereby can be eager to interact with people. In relations with humans, elementals can be both good and evil. A water elemental spirit, also known as an undine, is often associated with prosperity and beauty. Yet it is also claimed that they can possess a house, cause mysterious puddles to form, and damage plumbing systems. More sinister undines are said to be able to take control of a human being, and compel them to end their own life by drowning themselves. In the Americas, folklore speaks of La Llorona, a weeping, ghostly female figure who lurks by waterways. It can be said that La Llorona, far from being a human spirit, is a malevolent undine, an elemental being who compels children to drown themselves. La Llorona, being a form of water elemental being, could go some way to explain why sightings of the legendary weeping woman have been reported all across the Americas, from rural Argentina to San Antonio, Texas. In Japanese folklore, kappa are amphibious monsters who attack those who come too close to their watery homes. Like La Llorona, these beings can also be considered to be malevolent water elementals. Just like humans, elementals can be good, bad, and every shade of grey in between. An undine which legend presents in a favourable light is the Lady of the Lake of Arthurian myth. It is she who gives Arthur the legendary sword Excalibur, and thereby plays a pivotal role in helping him become king. thus the association between water elementals and prosperity. In Celtic mythology, many lakes are still considered magical to this day, due in part to the ancient belief in water elementals. Earth elementals, also known as gnomes, are equally considered to be both good and bad. Sometimes described as small men 2 to 3 feet tall, usually bearded and dressed in caps, benevolent gnomes appear in folklore to lead people to treasures hidden within the earth. In the 19th century, Bohemian and Hungarian miners believed that gnomes would produce knocking noises within the rock to communicate to them whether there was treasure or danger ahead. Similar is the Tommyknocker, an elemental first described by miners in northern England. Whilst occasionally helpful, these beings are almost always described as mischievous, a temperament which can make them dangerous when working in mineshafts. Some of the more malevolent earth elementals are thought to instill within people fears of being buried alive. Agoraphobia, the fear of leaving home, is also considered by some occultists to be a sign of an earth elemental haunting. Gnomes are perhaps one of the more tangible elementals. They have a rich folklore which describes them as existing in many forms across the world. In some ways, they can be considered to be the most harmless of elemental spirits. One of the more dangerous elemental spirits are those said to inhabit fire, otherwise known as salamanders. The philosopher Paracelsus describes salamanders as appearing as balls of light or tongues of fire. It is for this reason that those who believe in elemental beings sometimes associate UFO sightings with fire elementals. Rather than being extraterrestrial spacecrafts, inexplicable auras of light might instead be elementals at work. In addition to appearing as balls of light, it is claimed that fire elemental spirits have the ability to cause spontaneous fires, causing destruction to both property and people. Yet, supposedly, most elemental hauntings are not committed by fire, but rather by air elementals, also known as sylphs. Air elementals are claimed to behave much in the same way that noisy spirits, or poltergeists, are reported to act. Sylphs are said to throw and break objects, provoke tension in human relationships, and as a result cause lots of agitation in a household. It has even been claimed that they can compel someone to suddenly jump from high places. With this in mind, it could be said that classic poltergeist cases, such as the Enfield poltergeist and the demon of Brownsville Road, were caused not by deceased human spirits, but instead by air elementals. All things considered, it is easy to think of elemental beings as evil, responsible for insidious hauntings and inexplicable happenings. Many activities which are considered demonic are blamed on the evil doings of elemental beings. However, according to some paranormal practitioners, this is a misjudgment. Alifa Levi, a 19th century occult author, described elemental beings as being similar to young children, who torment those more who busy themselves with them. In his writings, Levi expressed a belief that these beings are fundamentally harmless. They can never manifest any other thought than our own, and if we are not thinking, they talk to us with all the incoherence of dreams. In this way, elementals may be able to influence, but never wholly direct, without some human input. They can implant the idea of jumping over a ledge, but can never be the one to push us over. This does not, however, lessen the sinister nature of reports attributed to elementals. In 1645, a teenager by the name of Anne Jeffreys was found unconscious. When she was revived, she stated that she had been assaulted by little men who she called fairies. She explained that these creatures had abducted her, taking her up to their castle in the air. This report of a fairy abduction can be said to be eerily similar to modern-day accounts of alien abduction. Such begs the question, are alien abductions actually extraterrestrial, or are they the result of elemental interference? Questions such as this one can really push one down the rabbit hole. Paranormal phenomena which one might consider to be caused by spirits of the dead, cryptid creatures, or extraterrestrials could instead be examples of elemental entities at work. How much of the world we know is shaped by unseen elemental beings. In this way, one could make the case that angelic beings are also elemental spirits. An example of beneficial elementals at work is claimed to be seen in the works of some Marian apparitions. In the 18th century, Saint Bernadette of Lourdes is said to have reported seeing a lady wearing white in a grotto near Lourdes in France 18 times. These apparitions constituted the miracle of Our Lady of Lourdes, and to this day the waters from that grotto are said to contain miraculous healing properties. Over 1,000 medical cures have been associated with its water, with at least 57 of them being declared miraculous by the Catholic Church. Even science has been somewhat confounded. An independent study declared in 2012 that the water's miraculous healing properties are currently beyond our ken, but still impressive, incredibly effective, and awaiting a scientific explanation. Some have claimed these types of apparitions to be the work of benevolent elementals, an undine or water elemental in the case of Lourdes. These are not exceptional circumstances. In general, elementals are thought to do more good than harm. Fire elementals are thought to have taught humans to wield fire for beneficial purposes. Air elementals inspire people and help to cultivate genius. Earth elementals protect the planet and can give human beings physical treasure. And water elementals, of course, can heal human beings and bestow prosperity. They are, in fact, seen as so beneficial that some occultists have devoted themselves entirely towards bonding with elementals. According to Godwin, Rosicrucian men used to make a vow of chastity in the hopes of marrying an elemental. In so doing, it was believed that the gifts of the elemental would be imparted on the man, and the immortality of the human soul would be shared with the elemental. Elemental beings may seem to some as the product of an overactive imagination. However, the roots of elemental beings are embedded into many world religions. In Islamic traditions, there are powerful spirits known as jinn, invisible entities made of smokeless fire. To many people, jinn are not merely folklore, but very real entities. A study conducted by the Pew Research Center in 2012 found that most people in Morocco, Bangladesh, Turkey, and Iraq believe in jinn. Jewish folklore has in its roots the existence of golems, elemental spirits created from the mud of the earth. In Buddhist culture, it is believed by some that a naga, a water elemental, was the first being on earth to receive the Buddha's teachings. Elemental spirits also play a strong part in the formation of Christian theology. Paul the Apostle states in the New Testament that before God sent his son Jesus, we were in slavery under the elemental spiritual forces of the world. Despite this statement casting these beings as slave masters, Paul did not believe that these elemental spirits were necessarily evil. Rather, they were seen as temporary custodians of people set by God, until he felt ready to send his son to free mankind from their custody. Paracelsus, himself a devoted Christian, clearly believed elementals to be God's creatures, commenting what marvelous works God has created when discussing them. Similar trains of thought can be seen in other theologies. In this way, these elementals are claimed to be ancient beings. However, some esoteric philosophers believe that people have recently inaugurated a new, artificial sort of elemental known as a tulpa. Through the power of human thought, it is believed that a person can bring into existence this type of being. Some have claimed black-eyed children to be examples of such inorganic entities. It is thought that tulpas feed off the energy of their creator, and can even engender a situation of perpetual self-haunting. In such a case, the tulpa becomes a poltergeist, constantly feeding off one or many people's beliefs and fears to stay alive. This type of elemental needs a human host, which, in some ways, makes it a form of parasitic entity. Adolescents are especially associated with this imaginative ability, which may help to explain why many infamous cases of poltergeists and hauntings, such as the Amityville Horror, the Vieques case, and the Enfield Poltergeist, center on young people. With the increasing use of the internet and story-sharing platforms, it can be said that tulpa elementals are becoming more common. Something which may have started innocently enough as a fictional story may very well be thought into existence through the collective consciousness of online participants. Such an example is Slenderman, a supernatural, unnaturally tall and featureless humanoid who, despite originating in fiction, is now considered by many to be a real entity who has been sighted in real life. A more recent internet sensation and potential tulpa is the Siren Head creature, created by Trevor Henderson. As there are good and bad elementals of other types, it is theoretically possible that a tulpa may also be beneficial, though such stories are less common. Ultimately, the concept of elemental beings is the proposition of a worldview whereby sentience can exist beyond the human senses, in everything around us. In many ways, it is a charming way of interacting with the world around us. Something that makes a walk in a cave, a lit candle, a gust of wind, or a beautiful lake seem all the more mysterious and magical. To many, the idea of such beings existing is beyond the prevailing rationalist view of the universe, and therefore ridiculous. Yet, new types of life forms are constantly being discovered. In recent decades, scientists have uncovered the existence of extremophiles, microorganisms that can exist in the most radical of environments, such as areas inundated with radiation and heat. 100 years ago, people would have thought that such organisms could never have existed. Thus, as our understanding of the universe continues to evolve, who knows what else awaits discovery? Perhaps, all around us, there is more to life than most of us can possibly imagine. Thank you for watching. If you enjoyed this, please be sure to like and subscribe for more of the paranormal. Make sure you have clicked the bell icon to turn on all notifications of new content. Also, don't forget that you can subscribe to my newsletter via my website to receive notifications straight to your inbox. And if you cannot wait until my next video, why not check out the one suggested on screen now? Until next time.